WHO has been assessing this outbreak around the clock, and we're deeply concerned by the alarming levels of spread and severity.
To delay the spread of the disease, people must stay at home.
Jake, and I don't know about you, but before being trapped in an apocalypse of the undead, I had two loves in my life, science and movies. So I decided to put myself on my favorite kinds of horror films, zombies, to learn how does a virus actually work? And more importantly, could you survive the genre? Could you survive a deadly microscopic pathogen? Having your limbs torn off by a zombie and a viral global pandemic? Hey, you know, I think this can of meat might still be good. Think fast! Could you survive a zombie movie? Okay, that was totally my fault. But the good news is those guys out there seem pretty slow, so I think we could probably outrun them, which is great, because if I've learned anything from the dozens of zombie movies that I've watched, is that it only takes one bite, sometimes just a scratch, for you to become infected. Wait, you weren't bit or anything, right? Okay, I didn't think so, I was just checking. It looks like we're dealing with the classic slow-moving zombie, which was common in films from the 60s, 70s, and 80s, and they were more of a metaphor for things like mindless consumerism. But then that changed in the 2000s with 28 Days Later and World War Z, where the zombie movie became more of a metaphor about viruses, and the zombie itself became this fast-moving, bloodthirsty, rage-filled beast. Which got me thinking, could a virus actually turn you into a zombie? And how exactly could that happen? If we're going to look at the science of viruses, first off, we should establish that there is no such thing as a zombie virus as portrayed in the movies. But viruses do behave like cinematic zombies in several ways. The most striking is that viruses are not alive. They only exist by hijacking a host and using it to make more copies of itself. Although most people think of viruses as germs or bugs, like bacteria, they're just packets of DNA or RNA surrounded by a coat of fats or proteins. And like a zombie, they can't reproduce on their own. Instead, viruses seek out cells in a living host to start replication, whether through an open wound, an insect bite, or most commonly, inhalation. All cells have surface receptors, like a puzzle piece, that allow important things like nutrients to attach to them. A virus uses those receptors to grab a cell, then dig inside of it. Once it's there, it releases its DNA or RNA packet. That virus DNA then uses the cell to make thousands of copies that burst from the cell and infect other cells. Another diabolical thing that viruses do is force their host to help it spread. Each human sneeze puts out about 20,000 droplets that help spread respiratory viruses like rhinovirus or coronavirus. Well, I am sorry about that. That was pretty gross. I should have covered my mouth. Oh, hey, Shelby.
Jake, oh my gosh, it's so good to see you. It's so good to see you too.
Have you been out there? It's insane.
I know.
I mean, I know they're slow, but they're relentless.
But you seem to avoid them pretty well. You didn't get bit or anything, right? You didn't
get bit. Yeah, no, I was just shopping at the Umbrella Co. and suddenly there was a horde of zombies. How'd they get in here anyway?
Oh, I have no idea.
Well, I was thinking about heading to the upper level of the mall. You know, higher ground and all that.
Oh, yes, higher ground. That's a...
Yes,
yep, good idea. Hey, you coming?
Oh, yeah.
Cool. It's crazy how quickly this outbreak has spread. I mean, as you know, modern zombie movies are really an allegory for our fear of a pandemic. And as the world is easier to navigate and easier to explore, that fear becomes more of a reality than a fiction.
Right, well, older zombie films were more of an epidemic, where the disease was isolated to a smaller area, like a single town or country. But modern zombie movies focused on the outbreak as a pandemic, something that spreads globally.
You know, it's a lot to think about. It's very interesting.
It's very interesting. Yeah. I'd love to think about it somewhere
else. Oh, yes, just keep moving, here. Yeah, because there's zombies and we're all gonna die.
It's science and it's fun, but we've got other stuff to think about right now. Let's go.
You know, zombies really love brains. And a brain has 2,500 calories, so conceivably you could survive on just a brain-a-day diet. I think the pretzel guy's stomach is in knots. But seriously though, it's crazy how one bite just turns you into a zombie so quickly.
Yeah.
Good news is, there's no fast zombies, so that's a plus, right?
Jake?
Yeah, what's up, homie?
Fast zombies, they're coming to get you, Roper.
Run! Go, go! There's a pup up there. That should probably be a safe place.
No running in the mall.
Matt?
Come on, guys. Don't run in the mall. It's dangerous.
That's my boyfriend.
Why don't you guys just run straight to the exit?
Oh.
Man, can I get that back when you're done?
Matt, behind you. I can't stop. Shelby, I am so sorry. But also, being horribly torn apart by zombies limb from limb, that takes a lot of power. Could a virus give someone that much strength? And that begs the question, how exactly does a virus work? Let's find out. You hate to see anybody get dismembered, especially my friend, and I guess Shelby's boyfriend, Matt. And sure, it's a common trope in zombie movies, but can a virus, zombie or otherwise, give you the strength to do that?
Viruses do all kinds of things to the body, but they're mostly detrimental.
Oh, hey, Dr. Brown. Why are you a video conference robot?
Well, you know, with the highly infectious disease taking over the planet, I just figured it was best that we weren't in the same room. But as I was saying, like, viruses impede normal functioning.
Makes sense, because the word virus is basically poison in Latin.
Right, and after all, that's what it means to be sick. But the idea of a virus that makes you super fast, super smart, or super strong, all that's science fiction.
Okay, that makes sense, but what about rabies? Doesn't that turn a pooch into some sort of super strength zombie dog?
Well, rabies is the closest thing that we have to a zombie virus. Both are spread by biting somebody. Both can cause hypersalivation or drooling. And sometimes this kind of jerky, convulsion-like movement. But although it'll amp up a dog's aggression, it doesn't cause super strength. In fact, a virus weakens its host by using the energy to replicate itself over and over and over again.
Good to know, Dr. Brown. Thank you. So, as it turns out, a virus wouldn't really give you super strength. If anything, the virus would actually just weaken you. But back to our original question about dismemberment and what happened to our friend, Matt. Could you have enough strength to actually tear a person apart? Well, good news, we have this device here to answer that very question. This 4-meter tall truss has a winch on one side and a stand-in victim on the other. Now, in between, we have a line that is rated for a pull of up to 4,500 kilograms. And then we have a dynamometer to measure the exact amount of newtons needed to tear this body apart. Let's do it. The average human male can exert about 640 newtons when pulling on an arm, which is about here. Clearly, our stand-in human is okay. But as the force of the pull is increased, we start to see the tissue and muscle tear. These connector muscles are viscoelastic, meaning they'll stretch a long time before tearing. The weakest part of the human limb is where it meets the torso. On the arm, it's called the glenoid labrum. And if you're going to tear a limb from a body, well, that's where you would need to focus. That was disgusting, but also really cool. It took 1.6 kilonewtons, that is 1,600 newtons of force, to separate the shoulder from the body. That's around 2.5 times greater than what a human being can generate. So, in real life, you don't have to worry about getting dismembered by a zombie or a person. Matt, however, well, you know, best not to think about that. Shelby, gotta say, you did a great job barricading this pub. Looks amazing, love the initiative.
Well, thank you, but why are we even in a pub?
Oh, because a pub is the safest place in a mall. Everybody knows that. Hey, think I could get a top-up on this?
Yeah,
thanks. You're a real gem, yeah.
Uh-huh, yeah. But why are we...
Get off of her! Come on! Like I said, safest place in the mall.
But why?
Oh, because they have guns over the bar, Shelby.
Okay, but why is there even a pub in the mall?
I don't know, man. Why are there zombies all over the world? Wait, are you feeling okay? You look a little pale.
Oh, no, I'm good.
Hold
on.
Huh? Did you get bit?
No, it's just a scrape.
Oh, no, you're infected. It's spreading. We gotta stop it. Come on!
No, that's not an option. That wouldn't even stop the spread, would it?
Actually, that is a great question. Would chopping off somebody's arm actually stop the spread of a virus? And for that matter, how do you even kill a virus? Here, could you hold this for me?
Uh-huh.
Thank you so much. Good thing none of that blood got in my mouth, because once a virus breaches the exterior of a body by a bite, by latching onto a mucous membrane, or by an injection, it spreads throughout the body, mostly via blood circulation. So, to figure out whether the old post-bite arm chop is a good strategy, we need to look at how fast blood moves through the body. Human blood flows at an average of 1.3 to 1.8 meters per second, and of course, circulates even faster when you're excited. So, severing a limb off isn't a viable, real-world way to combat a virus, because by the time you did it, the virus would have spread throughout your body. But there are essentially three categories of things that kill, or at least mitigate, a virus.
You're right, Jake. It breaks down into three categories, okay?
Things that the body does itself, that's your immune system. Things the body does with outside technological help, those would be vaccines. And then things that the body does without the assistance of the human immune system, and that'd be like antivirals and viruses.
Your skin, saliva, and mucus are the first line of defense to battle viruses. And also, when you get a fever from being sick, what your body is doing is increasing the temperature to try and kill said virus.
Right. But by no means are those a perfect defense. So, the next line of defense is your bloodstream,
where antibodies created by white blood cells and lymph nodes battle the virus.
The only problem is that your immune system takes a long time to figure out how to make these antibodies. And when you're battling a deadly virus, no one has the luxury of time. That's where a vaccine comes in.
Vaccines have typically been built around weakened or dead versions of the pathogens, teaching your body how to make the antibodies so it's ready if it's infected by the virus. But in the fight against COVID-19, scientists have used a new type of vaccine, mRNA vaccine, which preps your immune system to battle a virus by focusing on just a little part of the virus, say the spiky part on the end of the coronavirus. Now your body only has to look for one small piece instead of the entire thing. It's honestly pretty cool. Which leaves us with virucides, things that kill the virus outside the human body. Simple everyday items like soap and copper are incredibly effective in either killing or mitigating viruses. Soap works because the molecules are kind of pin-shaped, and the round head is hydrophilic, that is water-loving, while the long tail is hydrophobic, water-hating. So oil and water usually don't mix. But what happens if we add soap? All those pins of soap molecules surround oil particles and rip them apart as the tail latches on to the fats in the oil. And since viruses are just packets of DNA surrounded by an envelope made of proteins and lipids, that is, fats, the same thing happens to that outer envelope of a virus when you attack it with soap. All right, buddy, I gotta go back to the pub, check on Shelby. Maybe I can still cut her arm off, then her and Matt will match. All right, I'm gonna go. Good news, Shelby. Oh, no. Oh, this isn't good, but we can fix this. Okay. You're strong, you're handsome. You can do this, Jake. No, I can't. Come get some. Oh, curse you, mall pub. What's my deus ex machina? Woo, trap door. That store literally sells zero umbrellas. But I think this should work. And, as always,
thanks for watching. This season on System.
Oh, no. Come get some.
Let's make me hypothermic. Tear this body apart.
Oh, the need for speed.
I don't think you're gonna survive this one.